Welcome back after the break. You're watching Indus News live from Lahore, and I'm Fiza Jamal with you for detailed stories. We start from Yemen, where the Saudi-led coalition has targeted Houthi rebel positions, including air defenses, in the capital, Sana'a. It comes a day after Saudi Arabia's air forces intercepted 5 Houthi drones launched at Abha Airport. The Saudi-led coalition earlier pledged to respond to a week of rebel drone strikes. The region's conflict escalated following the Houthi missile attack on the kingdom's southwest, which wounded 20 people. In Kyrgyzstan, Prime Minister Imran Khan has met Russia's President Vladimir Putin on the sidelines of the Shanghai Cooperation Organization summit. Pakistan's Foreign Office says they discussed the Afghanistan conflict, the Middle East, and Kashmir. Foreign Minister Shah Mahmood Qureshi says the Prime Minister also spoke to his Indian counterpart Narendra Modi. Qureshi says Pakistan has extended an olive branch, but it appears India does not want to leave its election mindset. He says India has to decide whether it wants bilateral talks with Pakistan to end any outstanding issues. Pakistan has signed 3 agreements to promote education, health, and cultural activities during the heads of states meetings. Meanwhile, India's Prime Minister Narendra Modi has criticized trade protectionism and unilateralism at the SCO summit. Modi called for an inclusive multilateral trading system under World Trade Organization rules. Indian media reports New Delhi may impose retaliatory import duties on 29 US products. Washington withdrew duty-free access to U.S. markets for Indian exports on June the 5th. The escalation of trade tensions comes ahead of U.S. Secretary of State Mike Pompeo's visit to India on June the 24th. At the SCO summit in Kyrgyzstan, Iranian President Hassan Rouhani has called the United States a serious threat to global stability. President Rouhani says the U.S. is violating all international rules by using its economic and military resources. Iran dismissed U.S. accusations over the recent attacks on oil tankers in the Gulf of Oman. Meanwhile, U.S. President Donald Trump says he is ready to talk to Iran. In an interview, President Trump dismissed previous threats by Tehran it could block the Strait of Hormuz in a conflict. Trump says he wants Iran back at the table but is in no rush. U.S. Defense Secretary Patrick Shanahan said the U.S. will build international consensus to the Middle East problem. He said National Security Advisor John Bolton and Secretary of State Mike Pompeo have been given the goal to make contingency plans.
When you look at the situation, a Norwegian ship, Japanese ship, Kingdom of Saudi Arabia, UAE, 15% of the world's oil flows through the Strait of Hormuz. So we obviously need to make contingency plans should the situation deteriorate, but we also need to broaden our support for this international situation.
Moving on from the SCO, the main suspect in the Sri Lanka's Easter bombings has been sent back to Sri Lanka after being detained by Interpol in Saudi Arabia. Sri Lankan officials say Saudi authorities arrested 5 Sri Lankans suspected of involvement in the attacks and sent them to Colombo. More than 250 people were killed in the attacks on churches and hotels on Easter Sunday. 9 suicide bombers targeted 3 churches and 3 luxury hotels. Afterwards, communal tensions on the island pitted Sri Lanka's Buddhists and Christians against the Muslim minority. The authorities arrested 2,000 people after the attacks. 634 are still in custody. In Syria, regime and Russian airstrikes have killed at least 28 people in northwestern Idlib and Hama provinces. War monitors say 7 civilians were among the dead. The airstrikes happened despite a ceasefire announced by Moscow. The Idlib region is supposed to be protected from regime offensives by a buffer zone deal signed by Russia and Turkey. The region has come under heavy attack since Al-Qaeda-affiliated militants took control there in January. War monitors say over 360 civilians have been killed since late April. The United Nations says the fighting displaced nearly 300,000 in May alone. A British court will decide in February next year whether to extradite WikiLeaks founder Julian Assange to the US. The United States has accused Assange of conspiring to hack US government computers and violating an espionage law. He is currently serving 50 weeks imprisonment in UK for skipping a bail hearing. Assange appeared by a video link from a London prison and told the court the US government has tried to mislead the press. Assange's lawyer, Jennifer Robinson, says no one should be punished for speaking the truth.
No publisher or journalist should ever be extradited for publishing truthful information, information for which they have won journalism awards the world over. This will set a terrible precedent, and it's one that no democratic government should be standing for.
Flash floods in China have killed 61 people. Thousands are stranded, while nearly 1.5 million people have been affected. The floods followed torrential rains in central and southern parts of the country. Officials say the floods have destroyed nearly 11,000 hectares of crops in Jiangxi province. Rescue authorities say over 350,000 people have been evacuated from the affected areas. 1,300 houses have also been destroyed. The rains have hit the economy with $380 million of losses. As heavy rains still sweep the country, meteorologists are warning of an increased risk of landslides and flooding. Clashes between the Libyan government and forces loyal to Khalifa Haftar are intensifying. The UN-recognized military says they have destroyed a tank belonging to Haftar's army. Haftar's warplanes have attacked government lines in Mashru al-Moz and Ain Zera, south of Tripoli. Pro-Haftar forces say they shot down a government fighter jet. In response, the government says it destroyed some Eastern forces' tanks. Neither side has confirmed its rival's claims. Turkey has warned it will take reciprocal steps if the United States imposes sanctions over its purchase of the Russian S-400 missile system. Foreign Minister Mevlut Cavusoglu said in an interview, Turkey is determined to buy the S-400 regardless of the outcome. Tensions between the US and Turkey have risen in recent months over Ankara's purchasing the missile defense system. Cavusoglu also says Turkey will not accept any excuse from Russia on its ceasefire violations in Syria's Idlib region. Turkey and Russia had agreed in September 2018 to turn Idlib into a de-escalation zone. The US has accused Russia of jeopardizing the safety of its pilots and crew with dangerously close passes with its warplanes. Russia denied the accusations, saying its jets were scrambled to prevent border violations. NATO nations are currently holding Baltop military exercises in the Baltic Sea. Russia claimed spy planes have flown dangerously close to violating its territory. It says the Russian fighters only escorted the NATO planes back to safety. Washington says Russian bombers and jets fly in the area several times a year and are regularly intercepted by the US. Wide-ranging conspiracy theories have fueled the outbreak of polio in war-torn Afghanistan. People's lack of trust has made the vaccination program difficult to enforce. Details in this report.
Afghanistan is one of only three countries in the world where polio remains endemic. A total ban on inoculations by the Taliban has resulted in seven new polio cases in areas controlled by them. The health ministry says that the ban will deprive more than 2 million children of vaccination.
Sometimes we have to go to the houses several times and insist on vaccination. That is when they get strong and tell us if it was a beneficial thing, you won't keep coming and bothering us.
The Taliban's ban on the polio immunization program has instilled fears among people. Families refuse to have their children vaccinated, putting them at risk of contracting the potentially fatal disease.
She got fever and couldn't move her legs anymore. When we took her to the hospital, she was admitted for 7 days, and then we knew what has happened to her.
Past decades saw a decline in polio cases in Afghanistan, but last year saw a jump with 21 new cases. The Health Ministry says raising public awareness among vulnerable communities is key to debunking myths.
It's time for us to take a short break. Don't go anywhere because more detailed stories are to follow. Welcome back after the break. Moving on with our next story. Protests in Algeria have entered their 17th week as thousands demonstrated for the restoration of democracy. Demonstrators have demanded the exit of all allies of former President Abdelaziz Bouteflika from government positions. Earlier, the Supreme Court ordered the arrest of two former prime ministers in corruption cases. The protest movement had forced Bouteflika to step down on April the 2nd after two decades in power. Algeria's Constitutional Council has scrapped presidential elections scheduled for July the 4th. It didn't announce a new date for the polls. Sparkling imperial jewels and royal jeweled swords will hit the biggest auction block at Christie's in New York in the coming week. Details in this report.
Precious diamonds, rubies, sapphire adorned jewelry and weapons are ready to sparkle at the grand auction. Titled as Maharajas and Mughal Magnificence, the sale will feature hundreds of items spanning about five centuries of Indian luxury. The auction will include a ceremonial sword dated back to 1880s, bejeweled with rubies and emeralds from Indian antiques. The auction also includes a pear-shaped, brilliant cut diamond, Ballet Devoine de Corsage brooch by Cartier. The head of jewelry at the auction, Rahul Kadakia, said a diamond turban ornament and diamond necklace will also be offered.
The sale comprises almost 400 lots, 400 jewels, weapons, objects, jeweled objects, miniatures that span 500 years from the beginning of the Mughal dynasty in India to 21st century jewels. So there's something for everyone with prices ranging from $10,000 to $10 million.
The head of jewelry at Christie's, Rahul Kadakia, said this sale is likely to set an auction record.
Well, prior to this, the most expensive auction that we had for jewelry, that remains the most expensive single owner collection of jewelry to be sold at auction, was Elizabeth Taylor's jewels, which were sold at Christie's in New York in 2011. And on the first evening itself, the sale realized $115 million, 115. So we look at this sale and think it's going to go towards that number and more.
The amazing royal sale is set for June 19th at Christie's in New York City.
Pakistan Army has won an international military drill competition in the United Kingdom. The pace sticking competition was held at the Royal Military Academy, Sandhurst. Military teams from Canada, Bahrain, Qatar and Oman also participated in the competition. Pakistan Army has won the contest for the second consecutive year. In the world of business, Mexico says it will retaliate if the United States imposes tariffs on its exports. U.S. President Donald Trump has warned Mexico of tariffs hike if it fails to restrict irregular immigration from Central America. Economy Minister Garcia Marquez said Mexico will initiate bilateral and multilateral procedures to defend its trade interests. This comes as Mexico's Senate has approved a draft law that would ratify the trade deal with the U.S. and Canada. The new agreement between the three countries will replace the North America Free Trade Agreement. Meanwhile, Mexico has deported 76 Cubans as a part of crackdown on immigrants trying to reach the U.S. Mexican Foreign Minister Marcelo Ebrard said he he will urge the group of 20 summit this month to pay attention to the issue. European stocks have closed lower amid the US and Iran tensions following attacks on two oil tankers in the Gulf of Oman. On the last trading day of the week, the pan-European stocks 600 closed 0.37%. Tech stocks underperformed, with the sector down 1.75%. Sweden's London Petroleum continued to benefit from the oil and gas surge, rising 2.5%. On Wall Street, markets were slightly lower during the early trading hours as investors digested weak data out of China. Stocks in Asia finished mostly mixed. France has opened a museum to explain the arcane theories and systems behind the global economy. The exhibition hall is housed in a sumptuous 19th century neo-Renaissance palace built by a banker. Details in this report.
Not everyone can grasp the complexities of economic theories and what fiscal numbers really mean. To make it easy for people, the museum is teaching economics to visitors through hands-on exhibits and interesting games. Visitors can also sit down at a negotiating table and try to hammer out a global accord on cutting carbon emissions. Paris University economics professor Catherine Lobochinsky said that people in France lack even the basics of the economy.
Economic culture is essential. It's true that the French are known to have very limited economic knowledge, even less when it comes to finances. And in our financialized economies, it is a handicap not to have the basics.
Catherine Lobochinsky said that in today's world, knowledge of the economy is necessary to understand international affairs.
The political debate is essentially economic now. When we talk about Europe, we're talking about money. How much does Europe cost? How much does it cost us? So we need to be able to detect lies. And you have to understand that not everything is possible.
The project was conceived by the former governor of the Bank of France, Christian Noyer.
And now we'll give you a quick look at the weather around the world. These are all the stories in detail we have for you this hour. Don't forget, you can follow us on our website. For full details, you can find us on indus.news.